In 1 Peter chapter 2, we read it, verse 18. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect, and not only to those who are good and gentle, but also to those who are unreasonable. For this finds favor, if for the sake of conscience toward God, a man bears up under sorrows when suffering unjustly. For what credit is there if, when you sin and are harshly treated, you endure it with patience? But if when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it, this finds favor with God. For you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example to follow in his steps, who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds ye were healed. For you were continually straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and the guardian of your soul. Many years ago, I went to a rodeo in Los Angeles at the arena. I'd heard about rodeos all my life, and I hadn't gone. And I wondered what this was all about, the cowboys riding, bucking broncos and wild bulls, and it was exciting, I have to admit. But one of the things that I noted was the guys that ride the bulls, they have a hard time, but it seems like that clown, the guy that stands out in front and has the bull chasing him, he's got to be the fastest and the best. But those guys often get hurt, I understand, and this was the occasion that night when they put the big spotlight on the grandstands on a man, and they said Shorty is back. Now, Shorty was the one that was chased by the bull in the last rodeo, apparently, and he got caught. And Shorty was back out of the hospital, and he had a cast from his head clear down to the back and both of his arms, and they put the spotlight on him, and Shorty stood and went around and took the applause. And somehow, that man obviously went through great pain, but somehow the suffering was worth it all. You could see it by the glow in his eyes on his face that day. Have you ever noticed a football star limping off when everybody's applauding? Somehow the limp gets better in the locker room, but something about that particular event of suffering, that it's worth it all. Suffering seems to prove value in our world. It proves worth. It proves even courage. You'll see men in fiery wrecks in car racing, the Grand Prix, and many others. You'll see political assassinations, wars, ulcers, strokes, fire in home when a man will dash to save his wealth. The gold rush days, even men sitting on poles for 200 or 300 days. All endure suffering. Every one of them seemed to find value even in the suffering. Stoics, masochists, sadists all find proof to their existence and philosophy in suffering. So suffering is not just for the innocent. It's not just the suffering of the Christian. Suffering is universal. But why does God even permit suffering in this present world? My wife's uncle, Mr. Clare Scratch, was a missionary to China. And in his long years of service there, he was eventually caught during the takeover of the Japanese during World War II. And it was a case where he was able to get his wife and child on a boat. And his wife was expecting their second child. And he got them on the boat and went back to finish up the last things, but his timing was off and he was captured. And just before he was taken away to the concentration camp, they gave him a few days under house arrest. There was nowhere he could go anyway. And the night before he knew he was to leave the following day to the concentration camp, he just asked God, he said, "Now, Lord, one thing I would love to have is information before I go to the camp. Would you just allow me to hear if my wife is alive and well, and if I have a baby yet?" And so he was at a home of a friend who had a shortwave set, and they were scanning the airwaves, and this was 1 a.m., and they just came across a station that was a shortwave station out of San Francisco, California. KGEI, I believe it is. It's now an FEBC station. And an announcement was made over it. "Claire Scratch, wherever you are, you're the father of a baby boy, and mother and son are doing fine." They only announced it once, they say, and yet God guided that particular program and event. But he went away to concentration camp, and there he physically was tortured. He later came out of the situation, skin and bones, almost dead, but God preserved his life. He went back as a missionary and then was captured by the communist Chinese. He again was put into a camp, and this time he was tortured psychologically. They didn't bother him physically, but, for example, during one particular set of events, every day they would come to shoot him. And they'd tell him the night before, "Tomorrow you die. Here are the charges," and so on. "And you will die before firing squad." They'd take him out, firing squad raise their guns, somebody would trot in with a note, they would read it, they'd say, "There's been some more evidence found. We'll wait." And then they'd do it all over again. And he said the psychological suffering that he went through was greater than the physical, and he'd choose the physical any day over the psychological. Psychopolitics and the whole thing that Beria did in his studies at the University of Moscow in trying to cause men to change their political persuasions, I believe was diabolically inspired, and it certainly brings about the greatest torment of all. But I noticed that in all suffering, be it spiritual, psychological, or physical, that God has placed limits to suffering, for he's the governor of the universe. The limits spiritually are placed through the Lord Jesus Christ. We have spiritual warfare equipment. Our weapons are not carnal, but they're mighty. And we can assert the spiritual hosts of heaven against the powers of darkness. We can be spiritually protected, and God will never allow us to suffer spiritually beyond what we're able. This is true in temptation. He'll not allow you to be tempted above what you're able to bear, but will, with the temptation, also make a way of escape. Now, our way of escape is in the ways of the Word. This does not mean that you will not have spiritual darkness periods in your life. The man of God, Duncan Campbell, who was used in the Hebride Revival, died right here as he taught every year. His last time to speak is on videotape here when he made his last proclamations, and he seemed to know that this was the end, and he had a heart attack that night in his room. But he told me, as I was traveling with him in the Hebrides one time, about 6 months before he died, he said, "You know, I had a six-month period of time in my life during revival that I didn't know whether God was real or not, except when I was in the pulpit." He said, "It didn't matter what I did." He said, "I was praying, I was trying to do everything right," and he's a godly man. But I said, "Do you realize that there are times that God allows you, like Job, to go through? Don't you think that might have been it?" He said, "I never considered that." But it really was a time in his life where he was being tested by Satan, but he still went on, even if he didn't feel a thing. Madame Guyon had a similar experience like that, where she went and she said, "All right, Lord, I'll love you, but I don't know where you are. You're somehow I feel cut off from you, but I want you to know I'm living for you anyway." And like Job, she was saying, "Though you slay me, yet will I trust you." And that was the most extreme test of all. But God will never take you beyond what you're able to bear, even in these tests. For then you learn to not only appreciate, but you also prove during those times the justice of God, as was the case in Job. And as God is vindicated, then he releases to you even the greater blessing. But he's also protected us psychologically. He's given us the weapons and the word. And these are mental weapons, putting on the mind of Christ. And in everything, giving thanks as protection. And during the time of worst suffering, God will give you an alternative to the situation in which you can thank him for it. Corrie ten Boom tells how her sister Betsy was praising God for everything in the prison. And finally she said to her, "Betsy, this is ridiculous." Because they'd just been put into the cell with the most fleas on the entire concentration camp. And Betsy says, "Well, if we'll praise the Lord, he'll give us a reason and show us the reason why we can be grateful in the situation." And there Betsy was, praising the Lord for the fleas. Now, I believe it's to praise the Lord because he is greater than the fleas. He's greater than any situation, and out of any situation, Romans 8:28 will show us that he can turn even the bad into the good. So as she was praising the Lord for the fleas, they later found out that the guards never came to that prison cell because they didn't like to get around all those fleas. So they had all kinds of special privileges of Bible reading, of prayer, of Bible study within the group and so on that the others wouldn't have in the other cells. So they learned to be even grateful for the suffering of the fleas. God is able to release this as we understand him and his purposes, not that he causes those, but simply he's bigger than those things. And as we praise him, he releases the alternative or the redeeming factor in them. God also limits physical suffering. Now, the physical and psychological come together. For example, in physical pain, you don't remember it after it's over. You remember that it was painful, but the pain itself, you have no memory of. You can't remember pain unless you still have a little. Yet you can remember a beautiful song. You can remember the beauties, but pain is something that doesn't carry with it memories, other than it was a bad event. Also, God has even given us limits to pain in unconsciousness. Whenever the pain gets so high that you can no longer tolerate it, you go into unconsciousness. And this is another limitation that God has placed upon pain and suffering. There's also a practical physical value in pain. It's a warning of greater danger. Now, it has a very practical purpose here, because the lesser warns you of the greater problem. For example, hunger pains warn you of starvation. A cut warns you of bleeding to death. If you had no pain, consider what a selfish man would do, even in the area of food. If he could make more money, do more things. And look what men do anyway. They'll drive themselves to their grave to get a little more out of selfishness. But at least the hunger keeps reminding them. And so men will drive themselves until they have ulcers. But finally, the pain itself is to stop them from their kind of selfish, wayward goings. But it also warns them of internal bleedings. It warns them of a lot of things. And so we find that God allows even pain for good purposes. But only the believer has ultimate meaning regarding pain. Romans 8:18, Paul says, "I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us." He simply says, look, compare. There is no comparison. Dr. Bob Pierce, who presently knows suffering and pain in his body, as he has been given up to die with leukemia, but he has chosen to go on anyway, and he's just now been down through Borneo and New Guinea and finding all the sufferings in the world in order to tell Christians about it to help alleviate some of these places. From there he went to Bangladesh, Kabul, Afghanistan, and so on. And he once said to me and about four or five others standing around, we were in, first time I met him was in Minneapolis in 1964, I believe it was, and he made a statement I'll never forget, 54, 55. He said, you know, you don't choose whether or not you suffer pain, but you can choose who you will suffer for. He's seen the sufferings of wars. He's participated in the helping of the innocent. Moses chose to suffer affliction with the righteous. He had a reason, and therefore he could endure it. Like Viktor Frankl said, Dr. Viktor Frankl, the one that took the seat of psychiatry in Vienna following Freud, has a totally different concept from Freud, but he makes the statement that only those with meaning and purpose in their life can finally endure suffering and go through it without dying. He observed that during the Nazi concentration camp time because he went through it. And he lived through it, he said, only after he found his purpose, and he found it in the scripture, a little scripture that was there in his cell, which says, love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And he found meaning. He found purpose in life. And as a result, he could endure suffering. Suffering, endured for righteous purposes, always promises us present rewards. Many think that we're talking only about the future, but there are present rewards that God gives us when we suffer for righteousness' sake. Not for our evil that we do, but for righteousness' sake. The reward of growth in the Lord. Maturity. The growth in character. The growth in Christian graces are all possible as redeeming factors out of suffering. A gracious giant of a Christian is Corrie ten Boom. Can you imagine her as such a giant in the Lord? Outside of her days of suffering, God compensates even here and now. But it's not just for now. Suffering endured for righteous purposes also promises future eternal rewards with Christ. And this is where Paul says it's not even worth comparing to the glory that's going to be revealed. Who knew suffering like Paul the Apostle? He certainly endured the lot. But the atheist, the one who feels he is chemically determined, can only observe that he suffers, but he cannot consistently even ask why or give any reason for suffering. He has no reason. And what a horrible thing to have to endure without reason that which is common to all, suffering. But our question is not suffering, but it's why the innocent suffer. Relativity of truth, preached as a fact, and preached as an absolute, by the way. There is no right or wrong, they say. Therefore, there is no guilt. I believe the motive is that they would dodge the issue of guilt in their own lives. So by dealing away with the problem, they say there is no right or wrong. War is wrong, everything else is wrong, others do. But there is no right or wrong for what they do, and therefore there is no guilt, and now they're away free. And they look around at you and say, look, there's no God. Look at the innocent suffering. How could there be a God, and especially a God of love? Notice what they're asking. They're asking an impossible question. They're making a contradictory statement when they say, where is there a God if the innocent is suffering Because when a man claims atheism, he denounces the basis of morality. Other than consensual opinion, there is no basis for morality, for right and wrong. Therefore, to speak of innocence is to speak nonsense. If there's no right or wrong, there's no guilt, neither is there innocence. And yet all atheists inevitably fall on this question of the innocent suffering as an argument against God's existence. But really, by even using the argument, they affirm God's existence. I was in some homes in Beersheba, in Israel, witnessing. And if you're ever going to witness with the Jewish people, you'll have to face this question of the innocent suffering. But time and again, they said, how can there be a God if he would allow a Hitler? Look at the babies that suffered and died. Well, if there's no right or wrong, then Hitler is not guilty. But you can't pull that one from their hands. And so they have to admit, yes, all right, Hitler's guilty, therefore there is a right or wrong, but in whose eyes? If it's consensual opinion, that means the majority decide what is right and what is wrong. And if the majority go along with the Hitler, then the minority has no rights. There's no basis for minority rights outside of an absolute in God. Every minority group that protests on the basis of relativity of truth are protesting for their own destruction, finally. So if there is no right or wrong, there is no minority rights, therefore what is your problem? What are you talking about? You're a minority? Take it as it is. You're not innocent, they're not guilty. Everything's neutral. But that's not the case. They know it, everyone knows it, because the innocent suffer. So the innocent are allowed to suffer in an evil world. It's implicit in the evil world that innocent will suffer. If you allow an evil world, there will be suffering. I better just bring up a problem here of the lesser of two evils which God faces. The lesser of two evils is a situation where you have to choose one over the other and you try to decide which the lesser of the evils is. For example, if a house is burning and in that burning house there are two children. One is a baby, another is a 17-year-old. You've got to choose because you can only save one. Which do you save? Now, for various reasons, one may be saved. For some, they would choose one, while the other would choose the other. But once you make your choice on what you feel is right, what you know is right to that moment, then from that moment on, that becomes the right, the other becomes the wrong, and it's not a lesser of evils, it's a right and wrong. God had this dilemma. In the world of sin, what does he choose to do? Does he choose to allow the innocent to suffer for a time, as Paul says, and then compensate for it eternally, as well as even some compensations here? Or does he remove the innocent suffering, and then the evil cannot find mercy, therefore no salvation for the lost? Now that was the dilemma of God. And as he faced that dilemma, he chose to allow evil to continue for a time, and that the innocent would suffer in it, to remind that God has a moral standard as an extension of mercy to the ungodly. And it's in that extension of mercy to the ungodly of the moral standard of God that backs what is already written on the heart of every sinner anyway. Everyone knows the moral standard of right and wrong, even if their conscience is seared. Romans 2:15 says that there's a difference between the conscience and the law written on the heart of man. It says the conscience also, as well as the law, being there to warn us. And so when we see that there are two, both the conscience and the moral law written on our heart, as given by God, the conscience, the mirror of our mind, can be seared, clouded over, so that we can go along murdering without any conscience. But you never are left without a moral law. You just don't see yourself in the light of the moral law, because your mirror is fogged. So a murderer knows it's wrong to murder anytime somebody starts to murder him. A thief knows it's wrong to steal when someone steals from him. He knows it's wrong to lie as a liar when someone else lies to him, and so forth. So the moral law is still there. They're not without the moral law. But because their conscience is seared, God gives them a social mirror, so to speak, called the innocent suffering. And there, when they see a little baby suffering, he may be a man involved in the mafia killing people constantly. He may be involved in a situation with a Hitler, a dictator, where they're killing constantly. But when it comes to a suffering child, somehow it becomes a mirror to the moral law in his heart, and he is preached to by the suffering of the innocent in a powerful way. You see, it amplifies guilt by contrast. The more innocent the person is, the greater the contrast of the guilt is shown to be. It's there all the time, but you don't always see it. But in the innocent suffering, the contrast is seen side by side. There's, secondly, moral power. That's thirdly, rather. First, it's a constant reminder. Secondly, it amplifies guilt. Thirdly, there is a moral power in the suffering of an innocent. His suffering gives credence to his preaching. We see this in the life of Paul, I believe, who was the convert of Stephen and the prayers of the saints of the people. God is impartial, so you have to look at the situation. Why is it that Paul got such tremendous revelation on the way to Damascus? Back it up. See the witness. See what a powerful witness he received, and I believe that any credit should go as the witnesser to Stephen. He stood there, Paul watching on. And you can just imagine Paul's quick mind, very reasonable, very logical, as he's watching the situation, knowing that if this guy's a phony, we're going to see the truth in just a moment. You see, liars make poor martyrs. And Paul knew this. So he watched. And as he watched, there would only be two possibilities. One is, he would say, "Wait, fellas, I was kidding. Let's get together on this." The other is, he would go into a rage, because men can die in bitterness. So one or the other, but he didn't expect the third, and that's to die in love in order to defend the truth at the highest level. And so as he watched, he saw, instead of bitterness and hatred or even cowardly running, he saw a glow come on his face and a love come from his lips in forgiveness to those who would kill him. Now that's something he couldn't take, especially when you realize on his way to Damascus, he was going there to kill other people. And he had the authority to do so. He was immune legally. But there was something higher than just the legal or the laws of the land. There was the moral law. And there were the laws of God that were involved. On his way, I can imagine, with the pressure of the prayers of the people coming down by the Holy Spirit upon him, he was seeing all of this thing replayed, thinking, why in the world didn't he turn and run? Why in the world didn't he curse us? Why didn't he do something besides what he did? And as he got closer to Damascus, the thought is, what if I'll find another Stephen? You see the buildup? He must have uttered, according to Jeremiah 29:13, he must have sought God then with his whole heart and said, "All right, God, I want to know the truth." And bang, he knew it. That's all it took. Just that one choice. And he was overwhelmed. Now, a darkness always runs from light. But when light shines forth, men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. So if the light comes on in a dirty room, you have a choice. Either turn out the light or clean up the room. When men refuse to clean up their lives because of the moral light coming through from Jesus from others, then they try to turn out the light. But even in the suffering of the innocent, there will be a moral impact as a witness to the people. This came about during the Roman Empire, when the Christians suffered so much at the hand of Nero and other emperors. And they were used as human torches to light the stadium while the sports events would occur. And during those times, More people were converted than at any other time. You can see all of society was changed because of the moral impact of their message. They stood there, suffering. Yes, they suffered. The Lord didn't take them out of their suffering, but He, in a glow of fellowship with Himself, gave them grace to endure the suffering, and as a result, entire groups and masses were being converted to the cause of Christ, so much so they couldn't eradicate, because the more they caused the people to suffer, the more the gospel became amplified, and the guilty were becoming innocent through the suffering of the innocent and the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, a convert like Paul, I believe, was worth it. When you think of a whole lifetime of ministry all boiled down into a matter of moments, the sermon of Stephen was the most powerful of the day. Wouldn't it be worth it to have a convert like Paul? So you can see God's strategy. In Romania, I met there a Christian brother who said to me, he said, "Now, many Christians outside in the Western world, they feel sorry for us when we suffer." Well, he had been five times imprisoned, and each time he was in solitary confinement in the colds of the winter and so on, 15 feet below the ground. And after he told me this, within 4 months he was back in that prison again. But he said, "Tell the Christians not to feel sorry for us, because when we suffer, it's like putting wood on the fire in a fireplace and the whole room gets warmed up." We found that spiritually something happens in our land. Every time some of us go through suffering, there's a spiritual warmth and glow that sweeps over our land in a spiritual move of God. Just pray for us that we'll be strong in the suffering and effective for Jesus. He saw something in the fellowship of the suffering with the Lord that releases the mercy of God in a greater way, and the justice of God in judgment can be withheld, and the extension of mercy and the spreading of truth and the gospel as a result of suffering. Whenever we understand that so much is being done by the innocent suffering, when you think of the spread of the gospel in Russia, I believe it's spreading there faster than most countries of the world. Many, many turning to the Lord in great masses. And this is across the land, and this is from our many contacts that we are constantly having there. I can say that I understand a little bit why God would reluctantly but painfully allow the innocent to suffer, because it still proves the value and the existence of truth. Secondly, suffering proves the value of the individual. The individual is made in the image of God, and if it's wrong to murder a child, then it's because he is significant. We think nothing of killing a cow and eating it. But to kill a child, we cannot, because even though the child doesn't know much, we consider it significant from the basis that it's been made in the image of God. So, when man makes a decision, his decision can bring either happiness or suffering to the life of another. Any one of us could decide to make someone else suffer in this room. We could do it by trickery, by slipping up behind them. In some way, we can cause them to suffer, physically, psychologically, or spiritually. Your decision, therefore, is significant, showing you are significant. The suffering of the innocent is caused by the guilty's decision. You could even drop it a level and talk about the influence of a man, where it's just the way and attitude of a man's life causes either suffering or happiness toward others. You get up in the morning and you growl at the first one around you. Your influence, though not a decision to make them suffer, your influence of your attitude actually brings suffering. And one comes down then and passes on the growl to the next at the breakfast table. And so it spreads. And this shows that each one of us are significant. We can start a growl or a grin. We can start smile or strife, whatever it is. Our influence is important. Therefore, the first thing we want to make sure is that we get up on God's side of the bed. That's the right side. And as we do so, then we can share that smile, that influence from heaven here on earth in a sinful situation called the world. And as we live this life, it shows we're significant. But it also equally shows that the man who's a sinner, his choices are also significant because he can cause suffering. Both can be caused by a man. Therefore, man is significant. It proves the value of an individual. Now, you take a man, for example, the saddest cruelty, the cruelty of sadism, Marquis de Sade, the head or the father of sadism, says that you prove your existence in committing cruelty toward another. Well, it's true that you are proven to be alive and choosing. But the choice itself proves that you're significant in God's sight, that he wouldn't even kill you even though you have that choice. He doesn't take the choice away from you until it comes to a point that in his wisdom it's intolerable to tolerate you anymore. Man does decide, but God judges his choice. Ecclesiastes 12:14 says we're going to be judged for everything, whether it's good or evil. Our choices are significant, therefore we are significant. And you'll especially see this in man-made catastrophes. When in Bangladesh, they had a monsoon that killed many and caused much suffering. That was one thing. But my parents were working among witnessing and praying and ministering to spiritually the refugees from Bangladesh over in Calcutta. And they were walking among the tents, and they were living at that time in tents and old drain pipes and so on. And Mom, as she just came in and just put her arms around and began to pray and weep with them that wept. The one thing they wanted her to know about in their suffering, somehow they needed healing, was the suffering that was inflicted upon them or their loved ones by people. Something they couldn't take. They could take the wind and the waves, but people, that was too much. And especially, it was the mothers of young daughters, 10, 12, 13, that were raped by men, and many of them murdered. And this was something that the women wept the most over and needed healing for. You see, man-made catastrophes are far worse than any natural catastrophe. Thirdly, the innocent suffering proves the character of the individual. Jesus, Hebrews 5:8, says, although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. Christians in Hebrews 12, chapter 12, we find will also suffer discipline and learn through that. And our character will be proven as well as strengthened. Romans 8:17 speaks of the fact if we suffer with him, we'll also reign with him. Fourthly, suffering proves the value of eternal life. Let's read in Romans 8. In the words of Paul, as he speaks at verse 31 and onward, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, suffering, but delivered him up for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is he who died, yes. Rather, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, notice all suffering, tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword? Just as it is written, for thy sake we are being put to death all day long. We are considered sheep to be slaughtered. But in all these things we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And Paul, the one who suffered so much, is writing here. suffering proves the value of eternal life. He's saying, how can you compare all of eternity with a little bit of suffering earlier in the chapter? He says, you can't compare it with the glories of God. And then he brings it down and says, now look at these things. Can these things separate us from God's great love? Oh, of course not. We're overwhelmingly victorious through the Lord. But finally, suffering proves the existence and value of God's justice and mercy. It shows us also the necessity of a just, merciful God in this world. Notice his mercy. Jesus the innocent suffered and died to embarrass the rebel's pride, to bring him to repentance, that Jesus the innocent might make the guilty person innocent. Let me boil that down a little closer. Jesus, the most innocent, suffered the most, died so the guilty could become innocent. That's what salvation is about, friends. This question of the innocent suffering is really the question of the cross. Who is more innocent than Jesus? Who suffered more than Jesus? Why did he suffer? And every other innocent suffering is in a fellowship with Jesus in a category of its own. This fellowship of the suffering of Jesus. Now the justice, it proves the justice of God. Jesus the innocent, the most innocent, suffered the most and died to become the judge of the guilty. You see, if the guilty refuse the cross and the way of salvation through Jesus, then they're going to have a judge someday. Who will it be? The one that's most innocent. Who else could judge them? But the one that suffered the most. Now, as we look into this in terms of the justice of God, I believe that God is brokenhearted and, yes, even angered that there has to be sin in the world and death. But death is separation and sin is the cause of all of it. Leviticus, we see that in the law that God wants the innocent protected and the guilty judged. But yet, God promises his followers persecution, which is suffering, and death. And he calls us blessed if we do have suffering and death. All suffering and social problems, I believe, are caused either directly or indirectly by man's sin. All social suffering and social problems are caused either directly or indirectly by man's sin. Sin is a choice. All choices have consequences that were meant to be deterrents. God says it'll either be a blessing or a curse. The sinner is guilty for sin. God is just, and as the just governor of the universe, he must have the deterrent for the good of the rest of society. Again, it's a limitation on the guilty. So a curse was put on man's environment as a direct result of all sinning and coming short of the glory of God. Natural catastrophes, I believe, are descriptions or manifestations of this curse. I believe they are God's balances to sin and consequences. They are God's sermons to fallen man that to repent of sin, for there are worse consequences to follow. Each natural catastrophe proves the Genesis record. God said when he created the world, it's good. But somehow there's disharmony. Something happened in a good world. And each catastrophe, we don't take it as a natural thing. Otherwise, we wouldn't even use the word catastrophe. It's something out of the ordinary. It's an aberration from the norm. A beautiful world, suddenly an earthquake. A beautiful world, suddenly a storm. And it's in these situations that we see the Genesis record. The Word of God is true. In Romans 8:22, the Bible says the whole of creation is groaning in travail, waiting for its redemption. Now, God warns man, I believe, even of natural catastrophes. Man could escape if he would obey. This is the theme of Noah and the flood, a natural catastrophe. For 100 years, Noah built on that ark. Every day he was pounding on it was a day of mercy, warning the guilty. Methuselah's name In the year that I die, the flood will come. For 969 years was a warning from God to man. Man could have escaped the natural catastrophe. Sodom and Gomorrah is another case. Without the warnings, though, without heeding the warnings, they knew the fire and brimstone that came upon them. God could have saved it with 10 righteous men, but there were none to save it with. Egypt is another situation where God in his justice even would not allow Pharaoh to let the children of Israel go until God preached his 9-point message. The 9 points were to lead them from one category to another, showing them that there's something worse to come. The book of Revelation is the same theme. We see in Nineveh, they repented and the judgment didn't come. But in Revelation, we see it's a buildup. Each time, as a greater and greater number are swept percentage-wise from the face of the earth. For a 6% of a larger population is not as big as a 6% of the population with a 6 removed. And each time there's an increase. And the plagues, and it's a crescendo of warnings saying, look, there's something horrible coming. If you want to see how bad hell is, look at Revelation in the buildup, and then you'll know that hell's worse. And if these will not cause man to turn, God has no final answer other than a place he prepared for Satan and his angels. So God may take a natural catastrophe and first warn, as I think of the earthquake in Managua, Nicaragua. I think of the privilege and blessing that many of us had. I've gone door to door in that very area that was totally devastated. YWAMers had the privilege of warning every person, and we went to every home and saturated that place with the gospel prior to the earthquake. We did it in obedience to God. I believe now, as I look back on it, it was a clear-cut warning to the people. And God does warn before these things occur. You can see them. But when man will not listen, then God judges the sinner. He may even use the same catastrophe to take home a saint. But in the case of the suffering of the innocent, God simply protects by warning or by exit or by leaving them there, whichever in his wisdom is best. And if he leaves them there, it's in order to project his message of what the suffering of the innocent is all about, which is the message of the cross. But God's judgment is never on the innocent, just on the guilty. I think, for example, even in birth defects. Again, as I view it, no child will ever go to hell before that age of accountability. And you have a child that was born, as was the case of one of the students prior several years ago that went through this school, who's now working for Young Life as a Christian organization. And they had a child that was born to them that the doctor says, let him die. And they said, no, he's a gift of God, a gift of life. I saw God produce in them a grace and a strength through the birth of this child. I know that as far as the birth defect, I don't say that it was the sin of the father and the mother. I believe it's a part of the curse in a general sense that there are birth defects in the world. It's a part of the curse as a result of Adam and all those that have fallen since. It's there in the world, it's a world of sin. But there's a redeeming factor for the Christian in every case. And I think of another family in Florida that show forth the love of Jesus in such a beautiful way. They radiate Jesus because they have a hydrocephalic, a one with a large head in their family that they've all shown love to. They're never embarrassed. They take them to church. They take them out. They show this love. And my, have they blossomed into what Jesus is like. You can just see them and see Jesus. You'll see this in cases of even the catastrophes that we call natural catastrophe. But you'll also see God's mercy in them. For example, in natural catastrophe, there's always the separation of the righteous from the unrighteous by the catastrophe itself. The Bible speaks of the tare and the wheat. Leave them alone, he says. I'll separate them. And this is in Matthew 13. The same sun that melts butter will harden cement. Your heart everyone's heart is proven whenever there's a natural catastrophe. You take the hailstones in Egypt. Some joined the Israelis, the Jews, and marched out, and they had mixed multitudes with them because their hearts during that time had been turned toward God. They made their choice. Others hardened their hearts, and they stayed through and endured the problems. So these catastrophes can prove the heart of a man. It proved the heart of Job. The whole issue of Job and Satan going into the throne room of God, Satan is saying to God, "You're unjust. Look at that. Of course, you're playing favorites with Job." God says, "No." And he knew the heart of Job was perfect before him. And he said, "I'll show you." And he removed the things that were around him. And Job, in strength, stayed and endured through it all. What a fantastic thing to be able to plead God's cause against even Satan himself. That was the privilege of Job. And that's what our privilege is in a sinful world. That's what the privilege of the suffering of every innocent person is. You can prove God is just and the devil's a liar in every case. If you fall and join Satan, then you've proved Satan is right, at least in your case. But for God, you can say he's always just. He's always merciful. He's always kind, even when he removes the protection that he's put around us. Paul in a storm listened to God. The others cursed God. The disciples in the storm called on Jesus. You can curse God or call on God. In any given natural catastrophe, somehow it proves the heart in a hurry. Noah was in a storm, a natural catastrophe. Jonah in a storm, and a natural catastrophe. And one going in the will of God, one out of the will of God. But in the case of Jonah, it turned him around. The storm proves men's hearts. It also proves that God's a God of mercy. For each storm that comes, each act that comes, whether it's a Sodom and Gomorrah, is a judgment upon the sin, but at the same time, it's mercy on the innocent children that are growing up in that society. It's mercy on the societies round about. It's the surgeon reaching in, taking out the cancer in love for the rest of the body. And God as governor has the duty, the moral responsibility to do so. So what do we mean by the innocent suffering? First of all, we got to decide who is innocent. We can't. But we can give the guidelines. He must be honest, obedient to God, loving or unselfish in order to be innocent. Only God can judge the heart. Selfishness causes all broken relationships, which creates all suffering. The greatest suffering is social suffering. But God limits even these sufferings, physical suffering he limits, psychological and spiritual. But when you see that suffering is merely the symptom of the cause of selfishness, and you look upon the innocent, the orphans of the world, the refugees of a war, the children of a broken home, this suffering of the innocent simply says that there are broken relationships because there is selfishness in the world. But who is it in all of the universe that is most innocent of all? God. And Jesus, who is God in the flesh, suffered the most innocent suffering the most. Only he can finally give us the answers. I read to you from an article from a paper called Right On, called God Leads a Pretty Selfish Life. At the end of time, billions of people were scattered on a great plain before God's throne. Some of the groups near the front talked heatedly, not with cringing shame, but with belligerence. "How can God judge us? How can he know about suffering?" snapped a joking brunette. She jerked back a sleeve to reveal a tattooed number from a Nazi concentration camp. "We endured terror, beatings, torture, death." In another group, a black man lowered his collar. "What about this?" he demanded, showing an ugly rope burn. "Lynched for no crime but being black. We have suffocated in slave ships, been wrenched from loved ones, toiled till only death gave release." Far out across the plain were hundreds of such groups. Each had a complaint against God for the evil and suffering he permitted in his world. How lucky God was to live in heaven where all was sweetness and light, where there was no weeping, no fear, no hunger, no hatred. Indeed, what did God know about what man had been forced to endure in this world? After all, God leads a pretty sheltered life, they said. So each group sent out a leader chosen because he had suffered the most. There was a Jew, a black, an untouchable from India, an illegitimate, a person from Hiroshima, and one from a Siberian slave camp. In the center of the plain, they consulted with each other. At last, they were ready to present their case. It was rather simple. Before God would be qualified to be their judge, he must endure what they had endured. Their decision was that God should be sentenced to live on earth as a man. But because he was God, they set certain safeguards to be sure he could not use his divine powers to help himself. Let him be born a Jew. Let the legitimacy of his birth be doubted so that no one will really know who his father is. Let him champion a cause so just but so radical that it brings down upon him the hate, condemnation, and eliminating efforts of every major traditional and established religious authority. Let him try to describe what no man has ever seen, tasted, heard, or smelled. Let him try to communicate God to man. Let him be betrayed by his dearest friends. Let him be indicted on false charges and tried before a prejudiced jury and convicted by a cowardly judge. Let him see what it is to be terribly alone, completely abandoned by every living thing. Let him be tortured and let him die the most humiliating death with common thieves. As each leader announced his portion of the sentence, loud murmurs of approval went up from the great throng of people. When the last had finished pronouncing sentence, there was a long silence. No one uttered another word. No one moved, for suddenly all knew God had already served his sentence. Let us pray. Jesus, you suffered the most, that the vilest sinner, guilty as he is, could become innocent through your redeeming work. You suffered the most and were most innocent, that those who would reject you would still have a fair trial by the most innocent of all. I would pray, God, that we will know and understand the privilege of the fellowship of your suffering is not a lack of justice on your part, but it is your effort to extend mercy to a lost world. And if we're to be effective evangelists for you, we're going to know the fellowship of your suffering in many ways, spiritually, psychologically, yes, maybe even physically. I pray, God, that we will do so with determination, understanding that there's a joy and fulfillment of relationship in fellowshipping with you at a level that is impossible outside of suffering. That we may know your purposes, that they will be fulfilled, Lord, here on earth as they're being fulfilled in heaven. Thank you, Lord, that we may have understanding lest we be wounded in our minds and tempted to ever call you unjust. Thank you for the revelation of truth for those who diligently seek it. In Jesus' name we praise you. Amen.